Okay, so my presentation will be more about the history, as Professor Emery was saying. It's very interesting to examine where we have come from to understand where we are today. But before that, I'd like to give a little demo just to get people excited. So I wrote this game. Everybody is familiar with Pong?
What?
Pong. This game. Right? So I wrote an AI for it. And as you can see, it's terrible at playing Pong. It's currently on -6. And it'll keep getting worse and worse before it improves, before we start to train it, right? So we are here. I'm going to talk for about 29 minutes now. And then let's see, check up on it afterwards and see how it does. So let it train on this window. And let's get started. And like all good things, it starts with philosophy. We're going to talk about Aristotle. And I know not many of us are very interested in philosophy, so I made a Spark Notes version of it. So before we understand what machine learning is, we sort of need to understand or define, at least for ourselves, what do we mean for an entity to learn, right? It's a very natural process for all of us. We look at something, we're able to say this is a flag, that's a bag. But at some point, we have gained this knowledge. So Aristotle obviously thought a lot, as philosophers usually do. And he came up with these four highlight points. He says knowledge comes from continuity. If you take a pill every day, you will remember to take a pill. If you take it once every 14 days, you are more likely to forget. He says knowledge and memory come from frequency. That's why we go to school every day and we have repetition of instruction before we remember things. It comes from similarity, or knowledge can be encapsulated by similarity. For example, if I show you a microphone, and then I pick up another kind of microphone, and associate the two, you're able to associate it in your mind, by yourselves, without me having to explicitly tell you why they are similar. And finally, it comes from contrast. So if I show you a green ball, and I put up a red ball, you will be able to tell the two are different. They might be the same object, but they're still different. And these are all innate parts of your understanding of the world. If we keep this in mind, we can move through the history of neural networks. I have a weird color cast, so let me just stop my training for the moment. I hope. Yeah. So as Professor Mohan was saying yesterday, neural network research started very much in enthusiasm in the 60s and the 50s, and then it sort of fizzled out. So the interesting part of machine learning is not just what we achieved today, but also the story behind it. It's not less than a 90s Bollywood movie. There's action, drama, disappointment, despair, success, right? So let's go into detail examining each part of this. So no reference to any commercial movies, just a neural network.
That was built in Boulder.
Oh. So the story starts with these two gentlemen, Mulock and Pitts, and their personal story is super interesting also. I will recommend that article, The Man Who Tried to Redeem the World with Logic, but let's stick to the academic part of it. So they, Mulock was a philosopher.
McClock.
Okay, quick disclaimer, my pronunciations are horrible. I have a cheat sheet here to try and pronounce them right. But McCulloch. So, he was a philosopher, typical philosopher. He looked at how the brain works and looked at how the neurons work. And he thought, perhaps it was possible to explain it in a logical paradigm. And he worked with Pitts, who was a self-trained mathematician, to develop the first model. And very imaginatively, they called it the MCP model, because M, C, and P. But, advertising. But anyway, it works exactly the same way, or approximately the same way your neurons work. You have inputs coming in, called synapses. And then you have a summation operation in the center, which is equivalent to the decision that the neuron would take. So sum and decide. And the threshold that they used was very simplistic, right? Now this is the start of all AI, and we're just breaking new ground. So here, there was no element of learning. We'll actually go to the next slide where we can see an example. So that's a screen grab from the original paper. And a fun fact about that paper, it had only three references, one of which was a mathematics textbook. But that started this whole roller coaster, right? They tried to build logic gates with these neurons, these neural structures. So they built the OR gate, the AND gate, and the NOT gate. So if we look at the OR gate, it's easy to understand how it works. Let's say you have a weight of 1 on this node. So whatever goes through here will be multiplied by plus 1. Similarly, whatever goes through Y will be multiplied by plus 1. And then you have a threshold or a bias, right? So an OR gate is expected to give you a 1 output only when you put 2 1s in the input. And everything else is 0. So if you try that simple arithmetic, it works. It will work for everything else. The AND gate, so the condition is equal to or greater than 0, the AND gate will give you 0 under all circumstances and negative where it has to be false. But this got us into trouble for many, many years, and I'll explain why later in the story. It is a story after all. The next gentleman to come along in this sequence was this man, Donald Hebb, and he had some very complicated axioms to tell us about how our brain works. And I like to remember that short phrase, cells that fire together, wire together. So if you perform an action and you have a neural pathway formed, the more of that action you perform, the easier it becomes to traverse the pathway. Some biological functions, some neurochemical functions, but for our purposes, that should serve the purpose. So if you remember Pavlov's dog experiment, that can be modeled as that. So every time you ring a bell, there's some synaptic connection there with the salivation function. And if you show food, there's a connection. So we are able to build these connections to the point where when you ring the bell, the dog starts salivating, right? Now, the next man who has given birth to the modern neural network as we know it, Frank Rosbaldt. So there's an animation here which I've just put up, basically just tried to train it to classify two classes. So you'll see how it's struggling at first and eventually it'll settle. But meanwhile, he simply codified Hebb's thought in code, right? So it's a very simple algorithm. Create the perceptron. He called it the perceptron. It's the same thing as the MCP model with the fact that you have an algorithm to teach it now. Right? Create it as it is. Put some random values. Check for the output. If the output is wrong, there's an error. Common. So look at which output is causing the error and reduce the weight associated with that. It's a very simplistic model, but surprisingly, it's very effective. This is actually the output from an actual perceptron. And I like how the timing was perfect there. you theorize this, you develop this, but you have to build something with it, right? So he at Cornell, I hope I'm pronouncing that right, built what's called the Mach 1 perceptron. This is an actual piece of hardware where he wired the electronic equipment together to form this neural computer, right? So it did just one job. It had to find circles, triangles, and rectangles. So you had 400 photocells. So they are cadmium solar cells, if anybody has used an old camera. Put it together in a 20x20 array and put these shapes in front of it. And the neural weights were adjusted by variable resistors, potentiometers connected to motors. So if there was an error, the motor would move, resistance decreases, and it worked. It worked fairly well. But unfortunately, you know, things can't go well for some time, right? You have to have bad as well in life. So these two wonderful gentlemen, Minsky and Papert, they wrote a book. Now, okay, another fun fact, Papert had two PhDs. One in psychology, one in mathematics. So very qualified to talk about this. They wrote a book and they said that it is mathematically not possible for a perceptron to learn nonlinear functions. What does that mean? Simply put, imagine this is your AND gate, right? We expect it to classify or draw a straight line such that all the inputs where we expect the zero would be on one side and that, sorry, all the inputs where you expect, yeah, a zero would be on one side and a one would be on the other. I might have drawn that line incorrectly. It's on the other side of the square. But anyway, moving on. You expect it to do that. Just classify that square. When you try this with the XOR gate, it doesn't really work. So in an XOR gate, you want these to be similar and these to be completely different, right? And there is no straight line that you can draw that will achieve this for you. And the book actually speaks about a single perceptron, and we'll see why it was kind of a misconception. But this spelled doom for all sorts of AI research early on. Funding's dried up, academics stopped accepting papers or would reject them, saying that this doesn't work, there's no future, people start working on it. And we had what is called the AI winter. This is an actual term I did not know about. There is a Wikipedia article, but for all intents and purposes, just a bad time, right? And this is when other forms of machine learning struck back. Again, not referencing movies. Support vector machines come from a simple concept. Imagine on a sheet of paper I had that same problem. If somehow using some kernel phi I could project it in a higher dimensional space, I don't need to draw a squiggly line anymore to separate it. I can just draw a plane,
just
right?
Think Rumelhard, 1986, who gave the back propagation algorithm
yes.
for a multi-layer persistron.
Yes. So that is coming with another interesting story about that.
No.
So 1986, Rommel Hart. So Wapnick actually invented the SVM in 63, but I put 2000 because that's the modern form we know it with the soft margin classifier. But anyway, SVM came about and it found a lot of favor in the GRSL community. I mean GRSS community also. Lots of papers, lots of publications, and all other fields and. Applications. Till this paper was published, the paper details I was mentioning, Rumelhart. Keep an eye on the second guy because he's going to become a whole lot more important in the future, and Williams. But the fun story about this paper is they were not the first to propose backpropagation. This goes into the point that Professor Emery was making yesterday. Write your research, publish it, because somebody else will. And will get 22,947 citations for it.
Aubrey.
So, fun fact. So yes, so it was basically this group that proposed backpropagation. And from then on, we invented other forms of neural networks, like convolutional neural networks with Yann LeCun in 89. Yann LeCun is the current director of AI at Facebook. So if Facebook is being too creepy and tagging your pictures, you know who's responsible. But this was in 89, and it was the handwriting recognition project. So US post office wanted zip codes to be digitized so that they could speed up mail processing. And he did that very successfully, as you can see. Some of these I cannot read, right? And the machine gets it perfectly fine. For those trying to compete, the current level of accuracy to achieve is 99.2 on this data set. So it'll be tough. And then something bad happened again. Again, we had a slowdown in research. Because computers at the time were just not fast enough. 15 megabytes of memory was a lot in 90. You couldn't train them fast. Convolutional neural nets even take a long time to train today. Right? So you can imagine this was really bad. And SVM had a clean mathematical form to project the data. It was much preferred. It would take another few breakthroughs and, of course, breakthroughs in hardware of computers to come to the point where we are today, which is return of the deep neural network. A lot of people view this as a rebranding exercise because deep learning is nothing but a neural network, but just bigger. Just because you have more classes and more layers, it doesn't become a new thing. But it was necessary at the time. Another interesting story with the life of Yoshio Bengio and Hinton. But in 2006, this paper appeared in Science. Which was Hinton, again, the guy I told you to keep an eye on. And they basically solved a lot of the problems that was plaguing neural networks at the time. I am going to quote Hinton, rather paraphrase him. So these were the four problems that were there that prevented people from achieving success before. First, the labeled data that we had, the training was not good enough. We were working with hundreds or maybe thousands of images at the most. Advances in computer technology, memory, everything allowed you to have tens of thousands of images, more volunteers pitched in, you know, and that's why you should all belong to society and volunteer to progress humankind. So we got a lot of labeled data sets. See, the ImageNet data set became available. So that. Our computers were a million times too slow. This is not an exaggeration. This is an actual, it was an order of 10 raised to 6 times too slow compared to what we achieved in 2006. And we initialize our weights kind of wrongly. So currently everybody knows to initialize your weight using what's called the Xavier strategy. So it's a strategy that doesn't allow the error solving function to settle at a saddle point. But we didn't do that. And the most importantly, they introduced a type of non-linearity. So we all understood that we cannot solve these problems linearly, right? We cannot draw straight lines. But we didn't know what kind of non-linearity. We were using sigmoids and tan h functions and other things. But the issue with that is the output is limited from minus 1 to 1 or 0 to 1. Now when you're dealing with more network layers and you're doing differentiation, the number is going to get smaller and smaller and smaller till it disappears. This is called the vanishing gradients problem, right? And it was solved by rectified linear units and other types of non-linearities. And then deep learning got everywhere. It literally exploded. We have applications in medicine, in remote sensing. This is a small recipe I found on a blog, but it kind of summarizes it. It's become this, you have a big set of data, you have a big network, you have good hardware, and suddenly you have learned weights, right? It's not exactly that easy a recipe, and there is a science to it, but yes, once it becomes an industrial application, of course, you have to deliver. And this is a small chart that I found that summarizes all the types of networks we have built so far. And I just want to spend a couple of minutes talking about some of them because I won't go too much into depth of each. So the most important one for natural language processing today is the long short-term memory or LSTM. So if you think of whatever we've spoken, a perceptron, there's no concept of memory. They're just learning some weights and accordingly taking a decision. The previous state or their previous output doesn't change anything. So the LSTM loops back its previous output through a memory array. And of course, the implementation is a lot harder than just saying it, but it does that. And it allows language associations to be made. Hence, it's very useful for natural language processing and other language applications. Machine translation is a big use of that. So those on that row are about the same objects. Recurrent neural networks and gated recurrent, they are the same things as LSTM, but less complicated. Autoencoders and family are pretty useful, and I'll show you application of this later. What they do is they basically learn a representation of the input. So now if your internal nodes of the autoencoder was less dimensions than your input, you have compressed the data. If not, you've learned a sparse representation. So that's very, very useful in network pre-training. So for example, if you have a challenging problem to solve and you don't know what features to use, why not use an unsupervised way to generate some features and go on to classify them or whatever your problem to solve is. There are some more networks that are not on this slide that are very new. They're GANs or generative adversarial networks. They are, instead of minimizing the error, try to maximize it. So they are fighting with the other nodes. And this allows you to synthesize things. So maybe you trained a bunch of cat pictures and got a word. Now put the word back and get the cat picture. So if you have seen Google Deep Dream and the scary images it generates, that's one example of that. Now to the question in regards to our community. Why do we have to do this? This is great for computer scientists to geek out over. Why are we doing this, right? We're already at the point where Sentinel is delivering about 1.2 petabytes in 7 years of its mission lifespan. And I'm sure Nisar will deliver that in a year. And as we go into higher and higher resolution, we'll have more and more data. But data sitting on your hard drive is data. It is of no use to anyone unless you take it and extract some information out of it and do some good science or apply it somewhere, right? Now, humanly, it won't be possible to process all of this by yourself. And of course, you need automated procedures to speed it up. And that's one of the reasons we do machine learning. Now the application has promise onto autoencoders. Polarimetrics. So you have a major challenge when you deal with polarimetric radar data, right? Imagine you have a building that is not facing the sensor, but it's oriented away. It's going to scatter the energy away. It's a little more complicated than that, but again, simplifying. So imagine a building, right? If it hits it head on, you have the whole pulse coming back to you. If it doesn't, you're going to get a different kind of target, which you can see in this image. These are both heavily urban areas, but the scattering signature obtained here is heavily different from the one obtained here. So how do you solve this problem? Because you cannot reliably train or take training samples in that green area. You don't know whether it's forest or urban areas or not. So we developed this, so this is the idea behind developing this algorithm. You can apply an Euler rotation on the scattering matrix, on the T matrix, not the scattering matrix. And that will allow you somehow to simulate what happens if that particular target was at another angle from the radar line of sight. This is known. And we also know another problem. We say neural networks have a restriction, that deep neural networks, they need a lot of data to train. Why don't we bring them together? You have a scene, and in urban areas, almost all buildings look the same. They're all cubes at the end of the day, right? So if I take one building, simulate what would happen, what scattering I would receive if they were oriented at different angles. So I do it in steps of 1 degree or 3 degrees. You have a lot more information to train on. And this is a very general information, right? So as long as the assumption holds that all buildings are similar in your area, you have trained on every possible orientation of that building. So, and your deep neural network needs that data to train anyway. So you've sort of killed two birds with one stone. And you generate, as you can see, this is a highly oriented area that is completely recovered by the deep neural network and other parts of it.
What are these colors?
So the red is the urban area, the green is non-urban, so forest, bare land, and blue is water. Just a very simple classification scheme. And if you compare it with the other contenders that we had before, so support vector, so we have to remember they have not been trained on the oriented areas at all. They've just been trained on wherever we saw that it's a pink scattering, and you know it's a double bound scattering. So if you compare with other contenders, even radial basis functions, which is considered quite well suited for these kind of tasks, does not recover as much of the urban area as the proposed deep learning method.
But it shows more percentage, 86.2,
yes,
area.
That is the accuracy numbers.
Out of total 86%.
No, they are accuracy. Each per on 100 basis. So 100. Ideal classifier would have 100%.
86 you have classified as.
Correctly. Yes.
So that's the accuracy. Yes. You are talking. Now area, if you see the NA, in proposed one B or BF.
Yes.
Then more of the gray area, how you say that?
So this is urban, you can see from, if you take a satellite image of the area,
not shown in the ground.
Yes, yes. Okay. So these are all, this is a densely urban area, the San Francisco. So
okay.
I've just shown very few things since it was not a technical presentation as such. Now, to talk very briefly of how the GRSS community has helped me. So first of all, a lot of my understanding of machine learning has come from following the competition of the Data Fusion Committee, which is a part of the GRSS. There's plenty of tutorials available from the GRSS website. And if you're not aware, IEEE has this networking website, Collaboratech. We'll get it correctly. I petitioned with another student member to get a GRSS community on that site, so that should come up in a few months. And don't be unfooled, don't ask questions in real life. Come there, find me, ask questions there. It's 2017. This is sarcasm. Please ask me questions now. This has been a morning of unnecessary detail with me. Since we have around 5 minutes left and I'll need only two to show you that demo again, let's go into some extra fun slides I had prepared, which I didn't address before. So the paper I was talking about, we spoke about, the first paper on backpropagation with 22,000 citations. Well, the first person to actually develop that was Verbos. And unfortunately, he never published it. It was a part of his doctoral thesis, which became a report, and nothing good came out of it. So now, in a sort of a memory of the 30 years of machine learning, it was mentioned in a paper, but that's all he has got, right? Whereas the other person who wrote it in a clear, concise manner, put it out there as a journal paper, of course, won out. And we know him by name today. The second part of this story is Hinton's story, or his personal story, which I also will take a minute to describe. So when neural network research started dying out and funding started expiring, he still had to work, right? And he wouldn't give up on his dream of building a neural network that could do everything. So he packed his bags, moved to Canada on the CIFAR fellowship, which was a Canadian government fellowship. It was not a huge amount to do his research. He recruited a small team, and they stuck at it for 6 years, from 2000 to 2006. No results, no results. And finally, In 2005 end, they had a breakthrough, and the rest, as they say, is history. So another moral of the story, don't give up. And just, I think Professor Shitole asked me to address one thing. What is the difference between all of this? Why do I intermix AI, machine learning, and deep learning? So this slide is borrowed from NVIDIA. And it's very simple. When we started in the 1950s, we didn't know the specifics of things. So we called it AI, and it still is the overarching dream that one day machines will be able to talk to machines without realizing that they are talking to other machines. Human-like intelligence, as they say. But once we started working towards that goal, somewhere in the 80s, we realized there's a component of AI that is machine learning to make the machines intelligent, etc. And of course, a subset of that is deep learning, which is just one of the many ways you could approach this problem. And there are, just because you see deep learning a lot in media doesn't mean this is the only way. That is, there is active research in all other fields also. And I think I will stop here. And let's visit our game again to see how it's going. You remember it was going into negatives when we started this demonstration? And in about 30 minutes, my poor little laptop, super cheap one, has managed to learn to play Pong. My 4-year-old nephew can't do that. So that is the future of humanity, I guess. And that is my time.